Please welcome co-chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and founder of Breakthrough Energy, Bill Gates, and founder and CEO of 4401 and winner of the 2022 Earthshot Prize, Talal Hasan, for a conversation with Bloomberg's Emily Chang.
Thank you. And thank you both for being here. And Talal, congratulations again on such a monumental achievement. I mean, pretty amazing. Bill, you recently wrote a book about how we can avoid climate, quote unquote, disaster. And yet we've seen record heat all summer, as I'm sure everybody here in New York knows. Give us your assessment of where we are now. Are we still on the verge of disaster, or is the world getting the message?
Well, we've certainly made a great deal of progress. You know, if you look at carbon emissions per person in a country like the UK, they're a third of what they were back 30 years ago when it was very coal driven. You know, there's a lot of efficiency sectors. And so it's pretty clear, you know, we're not going to go to the extreme scenarios because emissions will peak and then start to go down. They won't go down as fast as we want them to. And so the temperature will continue to rise. And once the temperature's risen, it doesn't go down very quickly. Unless you do massive carbon removal, you basically are at that equilibrium temperature and you have to do the adaptation. So people should feel good, particularly about the upstream innovation. It's very exciting across every area of emission that since 2015, when the innovation agenda got supercharged, we've seen fantastic progress. And now we need to roll that out in a very fast process, which the scale of it's bigger than anything humanity's ever done.
Well, and I wonder if we should feel good about the level of investing, because obviously you have invested personally billions and through your organization, Breakthrough Energy, but also climate tech has hit record levels. Climate tech investing has hit record levels recently. Is it enough?
Well, we can always use more upstream investment, but certainly in the financial environment we were in until a year ago, the rise from 2015, you know, where it was somewhat out of fashion because there had been a lot of losses, the rise until a year ago was pretty gigantic. And, you know, Breakthrough Energy has 100 companies. There's several hundred other really good companies. And so I didn't expect in some of the toughest areas like steel and cement and agriculture to see there are solutions that will, once their technology is rolled out, scaled up, and matures, get to this magic green premium of zero, where you can go to the, you know, middle-income countries that are 60% of emissions and say to them, hey, you have to make steel a new way, but that steel will not be more expensive. Likewise for cement or beef or dairy. In 2015, when this got kicked off in Paris, we didn't know how successful the innovation would be. And it's been far more successful than I expected. So you know, we need to fund these projects. We need to get them scaled up. But you know, innovation is delivering very well.
So one of the organizations Breakthrough backs is, of course, 4401, not 4401. It's 4401, according to the scientists. Talk to us, Talal, about your carbon removal solution, because this is a massively hard problem, and especially storage is a really hard problem. What makes your technology different?
Absolutely. Thank you, Emily. So we eliminate CO2. That's what we do. And we do that by a process called mineralization. So we have a rock on this planet called pyritite, typically found 40 kilometers in the subsurface. However, it's been pushed up to the surface in certain places around the world. And pyritite's quite special because it's really reactive with carbon dioxide. So when it comes in contact with CO2, it actually mineralizes it. And you can see these white veins over here in the rock. Just pass it over to you if you want to have a closer look. So this is a natural process. And what we are doing with our technology is we are speeding up this natural process by about 100,000 times. So rather than it taking decades in nature, we're speeding it up to months. Mm. Now, because we're converting it into a rock, this is considered the gold standard of carbon storage. So it means that you don't need to monitor, you don't need to insure it, and it gives carbon credit buyers certainty that the CO2 is converted into rock. They never have to worry about it again.
So it's there forever.
It is there forever.
Bill, why is carbon removal so important, and why do you think 4401's technology in particular is scalable?
Well, you know, the temperature rise is proportional to how much greenhouse gas is sitting in the atmosphere. And if you don't do what 4101 does, it stays there for literally thousands of years. It also acidifies the ocean, so it's very bad. And so the only way you go back in time to lower parts per million is by having carbon removal technologies. You know, there's companies like Climeworks, which for a little over $500 a ton, they're up in Iceland at a modest scale doing this work. And so the goal is to get that cost per ton down. They've been the gold standard because they also mineralize. And now we have, you know, carbon engineering, which Occidental just bought. We've got other approaches. Getting down to $100 to $50, it makes a huge difference because it's expensive. If you're going to do 10 billion tons at $100, that's $1 trillion a year, you know, which is eight times all foreign aid. It's a serious number in a collective action problem like this. So if you can get down to 50, you know, which graphite probably does, or below 50, which 4401, you know, has that as their design point, it brings in this additional tool that reduces the temperature rise.
Talal, how impactful has the Earthshot Prize, winning this prize, been for you and for the company and working with Breakthrough and Bill in particular?
Wow, how long have we got? So with the Earthshot Prize, I'll start there. It has been absolutely phenomenal for us. So just going out there, talking about the technology, making people aware of it has really helped us with customer traction. Obviously, as a startup, customer traction is really key. So so that's been great. On the Breakthrough side, you know, you have a fund that's arguably got the largest green tech portfolio in the market. So they have expert knowledge on how to scale, how to raise, how to mentor, how to coach. And these have been pieces that have absolutely been critical for us to take our technology to the next level. But then finally, what's really interesting with both entities is that they have an extensive portfolio, but also they have really strong partnerships. And we've been able to leverage those partnerships to help us scale the technology.
Climate technology, Bill, super capital intensive, takes time and patience to invest and then wait for it to scale, right? How should everybody else be thinking about climate tech investing?
Well, climate requires a lot of philanthropic capital, not investing, where you're funding policy groups, where you're accelerating implementation of things like the IRA, where you're getting experts to think through grid policy and remove that, which is a gigantic bottleneck everywhere. So we need lots of philanthropic capital. You know, early stage science thing is done philanthropically. Then if it reaches a certain stage, then it becomes venture investing. High risk investing, but those portfolios, you know, today look like they're going to be quite successful. So we need more of both of those things. There's several side meetings this week with climate philanthropists, lots of new people coming into it, lots of ways that we're organizing that money. And so Breakthrough Energy is very proud of the fact that because we have such a strong technical team, we're able to validate these investments. And so for every dollar we put in, there's usually $4 or $5 from other investors who, you know, we enjoy partnering with because they bring local knowledge or contacts and things that can help these companies go global.
So in closing, give us your level of optimism at this point. Are we gonna be okay?
Well, there's a lot of climate exaggeration, you know, that climate is not the end of the planet. So the planet's gonna be fine. We're not going to completely reverse development. So, you know, when we went from 10 million kids dying per year, in the year 2000 down to 5 million. We're not going to reverse that. It's going to slow down our progress. And so things like climate adaptation, which doesn't get hardly any visibility, that's become very important for the poorer countries. And yes, it is a burden on them, a significant burden on them that, you know, it's not, they didn't create the problem, we created the problem. So this is all numbers. You know, will we hit 1.5 degrees? No. Will we hit 3 degrees? No. We'll be below, we'll be in that range. The lower, the better. And the, you know, the sense of progress, it's important for people to see that emissions in many areas have come down, and at least at the lab level, we have economic solutions for every kind of emission.
All right, well, that's comforting-ish, I think. Bill and Talal, thank you so much. We're going to meet the three finalists nominated for this year's prize right now.